Thanks for checking out a message. Here at Centerpoint, our goal is to be positive, relevant, and real, and help you take the next step in your relationship with God. Enjoy.
Has anybody heard this song before? Who has? Okay, so lots of us have. Okay, great. So it's by Jelly Roll, and he sings this song, and some of the lyrics that stuck out to me was like, I'm barely getting by, he says, losing sleep at night. I know I can't be the only one feeling this way. Almost stayed in my bed, voices in my head. Some days it's not bad, but then I'm holding on for dear life again. Have you felt any of those feelings before? Like, it could be with, like, your mental health. It could be with your hope to keep living. It could be just your frustrations or disappointments or the highs and lows of maybe it's married life or your financial state or family dynamic or friendships or work position, whatever it is. You just wish you'd be at a different place at this point. It could be your thoughts, or you thought things would just be better or just different even. And it isn't sitting well with you. You don't feel all right. You're not okay. Some of us share this out loud to other people. Many of us keep it to ourselves, but a lot of us are still not okay. There are two different stories that we're going to kind of look at throughout this whole time together this morning. The stories that I can recall who have had, they're two different people, very different people, completely different stories, but they had what I imagine, at least, these I'm not okay moments. And again, I'm kind of picturing maybe what went on in their life prior to what we actually know about them, but I think they connect with what Jelly Roll sings about. One is with a young woman, probably late teen in her 20s. Life is going great for her. I imagine that she started off doing like going really well. Things were going great. Good family, good finances, financially set, understands God, very little trauma, maybe married even. Honestly, doing well in the world. Yet she has this thing that pops up that makes her difficult to be around. Honestly, people are telling others, avoid her. Don't go to her. She is perceived as damaged or dangerous or no good. And even though what she's going through is of no control of her own, I imagine her family abandoned her, and in their eyes, she'll never be worthy. So she does everything she can to obviously fix her situation, does all the right things, spends her funds and makes it to try and make it better, yet nothing fixes it for her. And she's living with this thing for years. Life is not what she was expecting. Her situation has taken a toll on her physically, emotionally, and spiritually. The second story is of a man who I imagine literally has it all going for him. All the stuff one could want. He's an achiever, type A person, smart, successful, an achiever. I imagine he's attractive, a leader, an influencer, has everyone liking him, and he's fulfilling everyone's expectations. On the outside, he's nailing it. He looks like he has it all together. He can perfectly execute anything he wants. Yet inside, even after having all these things, feels kind of meh still. Empty. Like there could be something more and he doesn't have it. Like he feels he is not good enough or it will never be good enough. There's something missing. These are feelings I think we can relate with, right? And this is what the song is actually being open and vulnerable about. It's confessing and stating, I'm not okay. I'm not okay, and I know I'm not the only one. For me, like, I would contribute to that as well. I feel like a broken record maybe sharing about this. So sorry if you've been coming to Centerpoint for a while and you keep hearing about this, but I've gone through moments where I'm not okay. My struggle has been anxiousness and worry. Like, I can and I really do believe, like, I have an amazing life. Like, I believe that fully. I love my job. I love my kids and my wife. Like, we're doing fine financially at home. Like, my wife and I, we've never been closer. Like, literally, it's great. I have great kids. Our health is good. But in the past, it would just take one thing to derail me. One thought, one person, one opinion, one struggle to derail me from all of that. And it would do something to my entire demeanor. So much so that it affected my productivity, my joy, my mind, and even the love that I would give to my friends and family. And it got me to a spot where I knew I'm not okay. But the last thing you're going to do in a situation like that, or at least for me for a while, this is where I sat, is if you're a person like me, is the last thing you're going to do is you're going to tell someone or confess it or speak it into existence. That is until you realize it doesn't get better on its own. And even still, when you know it doesn't just go away, you may still never share. But there is this growing amount of information and research out there these days that says to share or to not share is to make it worse. Many mental health organizations declare that if you don't seek help, like, it can escalate, you experience chronic pain, chronic physical health issues, instability in your daily life, incarceration potentially, substance abuse, suicide. That last one seems really harsh, but 90% of suicides are attributed to a mental illness that wasn't treated. Like, being open and vulnerable, confession of a struggle that's going on within you, seeking help, being unashamed that you're not okay, is one of the first parts of healing and can bring healing in itself. Like, don't hear me wrong, that professional treatment and help from others is important for many, but there can be significant healing with just you saying to yourself, to your friends or family, or to God even, that you're not okay, and having that come from the heart. This is actually what Jesus advocated for in his life. Jesus says in Matthew 11, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." He's saying, come to me, as in sit and read and be with me and try to connect with me. Follow my ways and teachings, and I will give you rest, is what Jesus is saying. If your journey with me isn't like that, if it's not easy and light, you're living life wrong, you're missing something, and I want to help you with that. Have you found that with Jesus before? I find it too coincidental that mental health struggles and stress, they have gradually increased over the decades, 20, 30 years. You could see it. But then you can also see that the church, or people that are participating in faith communities, is in decline for the last 20, 30 years. Is this coincidence that these go hand in hand? Is it coincidence that a place designed to help people get close to Jesus, where they're encouraged to forgive, that is others, and then also themselves, to release burdens, that is in decline, while also more people than ever are stressed? Is it coincidence that people are getting more stressed and worried and holding on to pain in a place you are supposed to actually find real support and community? The church is getting less encouraged and less prioritized. I mean, to be humble and confess to others and forgive yourself and acknowledge hardships within you is nothing new to Scripture. It might be like kind of taboo to do in the American church, but it is not taboo in the Bible. So it absolutely should not be taboo in the church. The Bible even says stuff like, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The Bible tells us, tell people you are struggling. Share and confess your conscious mistakes. But you should also confess and share things like worry going on with you, stress, depression. It is a sin to worry or be stressed because it's showing a lack of trust in God, and it's a state He doesn't want you in. God knows we're going to go through stuff like this, like Jelly Roll sings about. So He gives us a prescription, confess and pray together so that you may be healed. Proverbs also talks about this. He says, "He who conceals his sin does not prosper, but whoever confesses and renounces them finds mercy." Again, confess, bring to light, and you will find mercy and freedom. Does anyone remember the game Mercy, like where you linked hands? Anybody? Okay, who played Mercy? Okay, first service, like no one did. All right, so I'm glad, like some, well, I'm not necessarily glad you're playing Mercy, but yeah, so Mercy, you link hands, right? And then it's like you just kind of battle. Like, and it's like at some point, someone's like where you're so twisted and you're finally like, Mercy, right? You know, you're giving up, you're submitting, right? Now, submission is a place we don't want to be in the game. Like, you don't want to say Mercy in the game. But when the release happens, when finally you do say it, although you don't win, you don't get the victory, you do immediately feel relief, and you do experience less pain. right? They release. Those that that know me know I've done like martial arts kind of my whole life since birth, and it feels like at least. But I have like this nostalgia for like the Karate Kid movies and Cobra Kai and whatnot. And I love this scene that is with Mr. Miyagi, and it's I think Karate Kid 2. And he's like holding this guy who like never gives mercy. So he has this opportunity to do something to this guy. But I want you to listen to what Mr. Miyagi says after the whole situation happens. Check it out.
A man face you, he is enemy. Enemy deserve no mercy. Daniel-san, ladies no wait forever.
You could have killed him, couldn't you?
Hey.
Well, why didn't you then?
Because, Daniel-san, for person with no forgiveness in heart, living even worse punishment than death.
A person with no forgiveness in heart, right? Someone without mercy, someone who can't forgive even themselves, it's like worse than death, he says. Although Mr. Miyagi is not Jesus, right? Not even close. Jesus does say, if you confess your sin, he is faithful and just to forgive you and purify you. Again, confession, or in other words, declaring mercy leads to freedom. It's the first step to addressing not being okay. It's the first step to probably combating your marriage, financial, relationship frustrations. It's the first step to like combating a hardship, whether it's a health problem or a high sense of worry or stress. So again, are you not okay? I love the lyrics Jelly Roll says in the song. He says, God knows when it's all said and done. I mean, God knows where you're at. He knows what you're feeling. You know probably something's off within you. It's just, are you willing to address it? The fact that you aren't where you want to be or should be. You aren't healthy. You aren't doing what you want. You aren't okay, and you need help. Well, this is where Jelly Roll, the author of the song, and his name is actually Jason Bradley DeFord. It's what he's doing personally, actually, as a person. Like, this song is by him. I think it was written for others, but it's kind of about him being open about his own struggles and internal issues. He's got a unique story of, like, just crime and dealing with, like, pain and being incarcerated for years and all of that. But he explains a little bit about like how being open in these songs have kind of made him pursue healing and kind of the writing that went into it. So check out this little video.
Today or something's just not clicking right.
Yeah.
And I just started being honest about that because the songs I were writing were screaming for help anyways, mm-hmm. you know? And finally they were like, you're such a jovial guy. I was like, no, but I'm the guy from the song more than the guy here.
Yeah.
And I just started being honest, man. Therapy, and I hate to sound like a cliche, but I started working on the cliche stuff they would say immediately, just getting out in the sun, started focusing on losing weight, mm-hmm. Cutting out alcohol, just focusing, just these things, but doing a lot of therapy work. A lot of what I put in my body changed too, not just with the weight loss, because I've been losing a ton of weight.
So he not only wrote this song about how people don't feel okay, but he's confessing he's not okay. And that sparked him to start pursuing other things, to start making sure he's taking care of himself. And through his vulnerability, it opened him up for seeking treatment and help and growth. And this is a choice to do, this choice to do this song with real honesty that he sings is impacting others today still. There are a bunch of, you can kind of go down the rabbit hole of this. I just give you a little brief version of it. But there are so many YouTubers out there that do like video reflections on songs, specifically this one, like Jelly Roll and I'm Not Okay song. And I thought I'd just show you a few reactions, but it's stirring things in people. Like when you confess this, it stirs things in others. So here's one example.
Who's holding off a dear life? Ooh.
But God knows, I know when it's all said and done. I'm not okay, but it's all gonna be alright.
Like, it's real to them. Like, it's kind of a unique setup, right? Like, two dudes kind of listening to the song, reflecting on it, but it's real. It's real. Like, you're not alone. I feel that too. Here's one other guy that kind of like went with it.
Not okay, but it's all gonna be alright. It's not okay, but we're all gonna be alright.
Oh boy, this one is gonna hit hard already, I can tell you right now.
So wow, right? Like very interesting to see kind of how it impacts people. When you confess, it also helps other people start confessing and being open as well. So this is a powerful song, and it's about a man kind of being vulnerable about not being okay. And in response, he's invoking these other people to open up, to be real as well. And this, when compared to Scripture, is exactly what Jesus tells us will happen. We're not going to be okay. He says, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I've overcome the world. Take heart, I have overcome the world. I want to help you see the other side. I want to give you rest. But it starts with confession. It starts with learning from me. It starts with having mercy. So in the stories I shared in the beginning, I don't know if you recognize the two characters or the two people, but they're from Scripture, and maybe I kind of created some hypothetical backstory potentially with them. We don't know exactly what the backstory is on either of these, but I want to read to you what Scripture actually says about these two individuals. So the first one was a woman, right? And it says, and a woman was there who has been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately her bleeding stopped and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. She had something medically going on, right? Something that people avoided, something that was seen as unclean, something that outcasted her, and she's hurt by it. And Jesus heals her. The other story is known as the rich young ruler. And it starts like this. It says, as Jesus was starting out on his way to Jerusalem, a man came running up to him, knelt down, and asked, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus lists some things that he should do and model, and he responds, I've obeyed all these commandments since I was young. Looking at the man, Jesus felt genuine love for him. There's still one thing you haven't done, he told him. Go and sell all your possessions and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. At this, the man's face fell, and he went away sad, for he had many possessions. And we never hear of him again. A man who has it all, who lives perfectly-ish, but then again, doesn't, or not really. So we have these two very different stories, but two stories where people show up to Jesus, not okay, two very different not okays. One that's like mentally, physically, and spiritually ill, and one that is internally not content. If I'm guessing correctly, I think you can connect with one of them today. But when you and I look at these examples, I think we can learn some of what is necessary for us to have happen within us, along with some of what Jesus probably wished didn't happen to these people, which also I think are things Jelly Roll addresses and prompts us to start seeing in Scripture, and he advocates in his song for. Like, from these stories, these people were either outcasted, alone, with people that maybe that were just unaware of their problem even. They were labeled by their problem. They maybe kept their struggle completely private. They had a facade on the outside. With all this said, I do think there is an appropriate response to these inner struggles that we maybe experience, these not okay feelings that are addressed by God's word. There is a process that helps get to healing that is actually set up now and clarified by Jesus through Scripture that both the people in our stories, I think, missed out on. So I want to spend kind of our last 15 minutes together just analyzing some of this, because I want us to get healing. And I think Jesus wants you to get healing too. Don't you want the rest or the mercy or the freedom or the release or the guidance? If so, I think it starts with processing what you're feeling and expressing it. You actually thinking about what's going on within you or inside and trying to name it. I won't pretend this is like an easy thing. It's not easy at all. But name what's going on within you. Name why you are not okay. It can feel like a whack-a-mole type game at times. Anybody remember whack-a-mole? We're doing all the old games right now. Whack-a-mole, where you had to like hit the mole. It might feel like I finally found like that emotion or what's going on in me, but then it shifts and it's not really that. I feel the woman with the bleeding. She knew what was going on with her. Her situation was obvious to her. But the guy, I don't think did. He didn't know what ultimately was his holdup on satisfaction and purpose and lack of feeling fully okay and content. And he needed to sit in it for a while to find out. And that's what I think this song hits on. Again, it sings, I'm not okay. I don't know really what's going on in me, but I'm not okay. Some days it seems better. Some days it's worse. Like, what am I feeling is what he's singing about. And this is where you have to do the personal hard work of like trying to discover what really is going on. Like, you have to process to assess, like, I'm feeling sad today, or I'm feeling frustrated, or I'm angry, or I'm worried, or agitated, or lonely, or overwhelmed. You name it, and then you can, if you can do that, keep going with why. Why do you think you're feeling that way? It's hard. It's hard to do, but for me to maybe kind of nudge you towards that healing, to doing the first part, many therapists say it starts by just maybe spending some time in front of like a feelings wheel or a wheel or something that kind of gives you the emotions that you could potentially be feeling so you can name it and express it, so you can vocalize it, share it with another. Like, this would be something that you could look at and be like, in the center, it's bigger, angry, fearful, bad, surprised, happy, sad. And then you can kind of see like, actually, I'm really embarrassed, as it helps you process it. Vocalize it and then share it with another. This is where Scripture's prescription to addressing our not okayness starts coming to life again. James 5:16, like, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. Be healed, or in the process of healing of your inner not okayness, because of your confession of your situation. And be as honest as you can. There was a study I stumbled upon this week. It was very interesting to me. It says, would you rather tell a police officer that pulls you over you are going 10 miles per hour over the speed limit, or to admit to the 30 miles per hour you are actually going over the speed limit? Partial confessions seem like the best of both worlds. We can ease our feelings of guilt and still get away with a little unethical behavior. But a new study published says that people who only partially confess to wrongdoing ended up feeling worse than those who fully confess. Like, what if that is what you are desperately needing? Your emotions haven't been expressed fully or as honestly as you'd like, and they need to be. This is partially maybe why you're still not okay and haven't gotten better for a while. Like, about maybe your marriage or the financial state or habits or that feel, how you feel towards that friend or how you feel about your worth. Like, to hold it in is potentially allowing it to brew, to be something more than it actually needs to be. For a little lighter example of this, to just get you thinking of your own situation and circumstance, this was something I hated to do at home. Actually, sharing what was going on within me versus holding it in. And it came with like our little disagreements and arguments in my marriage. I knew I needed to start sharing things out loud. Now, disclaimer, my wife is amazing. I love her to death. She is so amazing. But I would at times be thinking, Sting it, Sydney. Sydney, come on. She left this thing out again. No. Or she forgot to do this. Or, you know, she said that about me in front of others. Really? That was private. Right? Or, seriously, I reminded you 3 times and you still forgot. Ugh. But when things like would kind of turn into an argument, I would have been holding it in all that time. I never would actually say anything like that out loud. I would just be thinking those things in my mind. And I would hold it in because like I wanted to keep the peace. And I thought that a perceived peaceful marriage is winning in marriage. Like, to not have a fight means you're winning in marriage. You're doing well. Don't break something that's not broke is what went through my mind early on in marriage, right? But when the argument time finally came, because it's going to happen at some point, it was go time. right? I had ammo. I had a laundry. You know, that time you forgot, like 2 months ago, you forgot to pick my thing up, right? And I could like list the things. But that was what kind of went through me. But for all that time before the fight, I was loving her. Absolutely, I was loving her. Don't hear me wrong. I definitely fully loved her. But there were frustrations underneath. There were things brewing. There was agitation. And it just wasn't what I know it could be, especially now that we handle things differently. So I started to push myself to confess and talk about the things that frustrated me. Now, this isn't a free pass for you to just nitpick and share everything you see your spouse doing that you don't like. That's not what I'm saying. But why not start sharing to fix the things that could bring full healing for you and them and the relationship, especially in a marriage relationship, right? Like, you've promised to be together forever. You're stuck with this person no matter what. Divorce is not an option. So might as well make more of the time better than half bad, right? Now, this is just one scenario, one example of this. But on a more serious level, like maybe you're realizing you are unhappy with where you're at in life. You're not content. You're struggling. You're feeling no motivation. You're barely getting by. Whatever it is, with work, maybe it's with parenting. Maybe it's with you're just not the mom or dad you wanted to be, or leading your family. You're struggling with that, or how you manage your time or finances. It's just like, it's hard, and this is happening consistently. You're unhappy. You're struggling. You're not okay. If that's you, you need to express it. And then you need to seek help and the right community to guide you. There is help and community out there for you, but it is not a one-size-fits-all type of thing. Meaning, they aren't all, not all communities, not all help is created equally. They're not all equally helpful. Not all communities and people do the same for you. Like, if we think back to the biblical story of the rich young ruler, he was, I'm sure, in a fine spot of life from the outside. He was, I'm sure, always chasing something to be the best, to have the greatest, to be the most significant, yet something was missing in him. Something was missing internally. And his help, the help he sought was Jesus, this amazing teacher who seemed to have this access to God. Again, the next kind of newish or thing that he wanted to try to pursue, right? And when he approaches Jesus asking the question, what more should I be doing? What do I need to do, Jesus? Jesus gives him something he is not used to hearing. Hold on to that statement, because I'm going to come back to it in a second here. The woman with the bleeding, on the other hand, we can read that she did seek community. And they turned her away. They weren't able to help her. She was seen as dirty and unclean. Bleeding was impure and for the religious at that time. Yet she sees Jesus, a person who didn't come to abolish the law, but fulfill it and show us how we can live with it. But somehow she just knows he is the one she needs to approach. And so she just tries to touch his cloak, and Jesus gives her what she's been longing for. Now, in both of these stories, these two people, I think it's important to reflect on them this way because they each had differing experiences with community prior to Jesus. And they each have differing experiences after being with Jesus. If you're a Christian in the room, this is the part of the message that you cannot miss this morning. Because this plays a big factor in what you should be doing. For the woman bleeding before Jesus, the church and the faith community structure felt she should be separate. She was dirty, unclean, unworthy. She did not get the community that God ultimately wanted people to provide to others. God's people were too stuck on the law and not loving, in which Jesus comes to fix. He not only heals her, but he identifies her, spends time with her after she touches his cloak, and he cares for her. And after his time on earth, he commissions his church, his people, or his followers to care for people like her. He ultimately corrects what people thought God has wanted all along, meaning to help and healing she got from Jesus. But a huge part of help in her not okayness, it should have came from the church, not just Jesus. She should have also gotten some of that care from the church, meaning the people living with her in community, but it didn't. She didn't. Which brings a very serious question for us today. If you're a Christian in the room, are you a help to the people who are not okay? And to be honest, like, I don't know if I am always, like, and I want to be, but it's an honest tension that, like, we need to get better at. Like, I was thinking for me, like, what that looks like, but where I think I need work is, like, when someone starts sharing things with me, they're finally doing that, kind of that first step, I need to make sure that, like, I don't repulse, right, or flip out, or gossip about it, or freak, or start thinking, like, oh, they're kind of, that's strange. We need to be the care. That would have been amazing for the woman bleeding. Whereas the rich young ruler now, it was a bit different. It was the opposite of what the woman got. Still not great, though. He is most likely idolized by his community. They probably love him and what he's doing. He's crushing it. He's a model citizen, I'm sure. Again, from the outset, he looks great. For lack of a better way of describing him, he is the perfect-looking, church-going man. But on the inside, there's something missing. Yet the stuff he's doing well with is creating more wealth. He's living more righteous and godly or legally. He's perfecting things. He's doing things probably to the max even. But there's something so drastically missing, not okay within. And that thing missing, he's looking for in these endeavors, actually. Some look for it in drugs or alcohol or addictions or adrenaline or pleasure. But his happens to be success, affirmation. And his community sees the success, but doesn't think anything of it. No one thinks it may be something where he might need help or communal support in. Unfortunately, I know this all too well, because I've been there before. Like I've been there making everything look good on the outside, crushing it, but still looking for fulfillment on the inside because I've been not okay. Slaving away to find it in everything positive, getting praise from community or my friends or family on what I'm doing, yet in all reality, I am missing it completely and creating unhealthy, obsessive habits. But for this rich young ruler, he finally meets this perfect person to guide him, Jesus. Jesus, face to face, yet instead of Jesus doing what all his community has done for him up to this point so far, Jesus tells him something that forces his heart to show he is all in on what ultimately matters. And in response, he leaves. He walks away from Jesus. He's not okay, and I don't know after leaving Jesus like that, like I don't know if this is appropriate to say even, but like I don't know if he was okay after that situation. Like this guy could have been the disciple of Jesus. He could have been number 13, right? But something was so off within him. Again, is this you? Are you connecting with this person? What these two stories show us is, first off, we need to be the church who helps provide healing and love. And we need to be the church that helps people see truly what's going on in their heart. And when you, me, we, all of us, start to get some of this from our community, from our help, and we actually listen and actually change, we start the process of healing. We hear the hard things that sharpen us, or we can hear it and walk away, end it, leave, move on, and look for the group that will just keep on saying what we've been hearing all along or what we want to hear. I know this is harsh, but this is true. Do you need to start maybe seeking help from a community that will actually sharpen you? Maybe for you, what that looks like is just starting to do something where you're connecting with people regularly, and that could be just being in a serving group that happens monthly here. Simply in a group that is now starting to develop a consistent relationship with other people. So you have to start somewhere to grow it into something more serious. So start there, where people are just connecting with you regularly. Maybe for you, you're ready for a life group even. Like, you're ready for people who you kind of are kind of saying, yes, it's okay for you to speak into my life. It's okay for you to start sharing things that maybe you're seeing in my life. Maybe for you, you're ready for a biblical counselor. Like, that's maybe what you need for your next step. Maybe for you, it's connecting with a mentor from this church here. I'm happy to help you get set up with any of those things I just suggested. But don't walk away like the young ruler did when things get hard. Don't be a crummy community like the people were for the woman with the bleeding. The last thing that I think these stories show us is you need to maintain your faith in God's ways and promises. The woman knew she was not okay. She had a horrible community experience, yet she believed God could be the answer. She stayed course with that, going to him with her pursuit of healing and purpose and help. And he did. Her faith healed her. For you, if you've kind of identified with her and her story this morning, you got to start going to God then. You got to put your faith in him. You are to go to God for help in your struggle. You've analyzed it, you maybe confessed it, you've sought help with other people even, and it hopefully brought you to God's word, to looking to God's word on in direction in that area. And now you got to start studying it. You need to start bringing it to your circumstance. You got to look to your life to start making it more like Jesus prescribes. So you go to Jesus, you find rest, and you realize his burden, the things you are doing to maybe repair whatever it is you're struggling with, your marriage, your habits, your struggles, your situation. It may not be effortless to repair it, but God's burden is light and his yoke is easy. For you, if you've never told God that you want a relationship with him, you want help in that area to guide you to start seeking rest, today could be the day for you. It's just simply by saying, like, Jesus, I want your forgiveness. I want your guidance in life. I know I've messed up. I know I need you. I want to follow you. And if you say that in your head and your heart, you're in the process of starting to seek help and also having Jesus as your guide. If you've identified more with the man that we've talked about today, the rich young ruler, after you finally get your answer of why you aren't okay like he did, of what maybe needs to change within you, of how God wants to realign you, don't let your discovery and selfishness stop you. Keep going. Trust his promises. What's interesting about the rich young ruler is we don't know what really actually happened to him. I mean, I wish, if I was him, I wish he would have just started asking more questions of Jesus. Like, what does it mean, God? Like, you want me to give everything? Like, what does that mean? Why? Like, help me see the full picture of why I should give it all away. I mean, if you do some digging, you can learn, again, we hear nothing more about this rich young ruler in Scripture. But historical facts do show that the destruction of Jerusalem and Judea happened about a few decades after this conversation or after Jesus' time, which is happens to be where he resides. So the rich young ruler ended up losing it all anyways. And he also lost his time with Jesus. But if you are like this man, don't lose your faith. Don't walk away. Maintain your faith and trust God's promises. And at the very least, try to move closer towards what God is prompting you to and in your not okayness. Like, honestly, I think that is what Jesus wanted from him. I think that's what he was looking for from him, because Jesus affirms what this man needed to do is hard. He says this, like, the disciples were, like, so curious, well, like, wait, what? Like, how did someone do this? And he says, the disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus said again, children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, who then can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, with man this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God. Implying you need God. If you're not okay, you need God. It's kind of what Jesus was showing this guy. You need to express what's going on in you. That's what we talked about first. You need to seek community and the right help. And you need to make sure you maintain the course with God and his promises. And then as Jelly Roll sings and kind of wraps up his song, is this is what will help you see the other side. I pray that God's going to help you in your struggles. I pray that God helps you see that it's okay to not be okay at times. I pray that you see that you're not alone in feeling not okay at times, but that God ultimately wants to guide you to a life that gets through it and gets past it.